welcome to Bharata First. You're watching Big Picture with me, Frank Razan Pereira. Since you're here, let me ask you, have you liked the video and subscribed to Bharata First? If no, then please do so now. Do subscribe to our newsletter as well to get some incisive information. And how can I not tell you about the Bharata First Knowledge Center, our big success story? It is your one-stop destination for all your competitive exams needs. We now have 26 amazing courses, all available at less than 1,000 rupees per course as part of our early bird offer. We are also offering an additional discount of 10% for the first 100 to register. There are only a few more seats available and for a very limited time. So what are you waiting for? Make use of this great opportunity and register now at kc.bharatafirst.com. Hundreds are reaping the benefits of the Knowledge Center. Don't be left behind and don't regret later. All this information along with some must-see recommendations are in the description of the video. Please go through it. And now, on to the discussion. December 8th is observed as the SAARC Charter Day or SAARC Day. It was on this day in 1985 when SAARC came together. And all the member states decided to work together towards regional cooperation. Somewhere along the way, however, over the last 7 years or so, the entire process has been derailed. There are certain analysts and experts who blame Pakistan and India for bringing in political differences into the grouping and ensuring that it has been derailed. The last SAARC summit that was held was in 2014 in Kathmandu. There was another one slated to be held in 2016 in Pakistan, but it has never fructified. How relevant is the SAARC today? What are the reasons for its derailment and where is it headed? Is there scope for revival? In this edition of Big Picture, we will analyze all these aspects. And joining me on the program today are Rajiv Bhatia, former ambassador, Professor Swaran Singh, School of International Studies, JNU. He's also the chairperson of CPOT. Also with me on the program is Sanjay Kapoor, editor, Hard News. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on this edition of Big Picture. Ambassador, let me start the program with you first. You know, SAARC has been on the back burner for quite some time now. And, you know, some of the nations, mainly Nepal, has been talking about how we need to see a revival because the region as a whole is suffering. How would you look at this?
Thank you, Frank, for inviting me to this very special forum of yours to reach the youth of India. I bring to you and to the audience greetings from Gateway House, my think tank where I work and contribute to the strategic community and its discourse. Now, to your question, I think there are two or three initial points can be made. I think it's not just Nepal, but there are many elements and stake players in this region who are full of regret and disappointment that SAARC has been receding from the policy discourse, from the academic debate, from the public consciousness. I think I would include India very much in that list of countries. I think India, Nepal, Sri Lanka, Maldives, Bhutan, Bangladesh, there are lots of people in the government as well as outside who feel that SAARC deserves better. The essential point here is that today I hope we will go into a little bit of history of SAARC and then how the SAARC train got derailed and eventually how to try to put it back on its track. So fundamentally, I'm a great believer in the concept of regional cooperation and integration in South Asia. I'm convinced that for India to play a big global role on the global stage, it's very important to have a stable, secure, peaceful neighborhood. Whenever things go offline or off track, it is the responsibility not merely of policy makers, but also intellectual leaders, public intellectuals, media platforms to contribute towards advancing in that direction.
Absolutely. And we'll talk about all these aspects that you spoke about as well, Ambassador. I'll take them up one by one with the other panelists as well and come back to you too. Sanjay Kapoor, let me come across to you now. You know, so what are the major factors that have contributed towards, if I can borrow the ambassador's words, the derailment of the entire SAARC process?
You know, SAARC in a certain way held a great amount of promise. And when it started way back in 1985 in Dhaka, there were expectations that there would be a greater integration of the region. There would be, a fair amount of movement which will happen in the internal trade, which is still very low. And things will start looking up and we will cease to be prisoners of our past and start moving in a direction where we will collaborate with each other. Because I think the strength of SAARC is a shared past. You have India, the big country, and it has, aligned with each other. In fact, it was one large country before partition and before colonial powers decided to hive it off in different ways. So, you know, there was plenty of things that they needed to do, bring in connectivity, bring in improvement in internal trade. And they had to be the most important thing, which is the credo of SAARC, is there had to be trust between the countries. But unfortunately, it became there was a collapse of trust between India and especially Pakistan. And time and again, you know, you had a situation where issues of terrorism have clouded any movement in the SAARC process. And the last time the SAARC summit was to take place in Pakistan, four of the members had decided to cry off. This has never happened before. But the major reason why SAARC hasn't taken off is because India and Pakistan have not been able to rid off the pressure, the shadow of the past, and take positive steps to move forward. We are still fighting in the same manner which we did many, many years ago, arguing over the issue of terror, issue of Kashmir, and that will hold the entire SAARC process as a captive. And there's no way forward in my reckoning till the time India resolves that, look here, those things will carry on, but we will not hold SAARC down because it has so much potential. And if you do that, the people of the entire subcontinent suffer, people, even Afghanistan for matter, which is the eighth member of SAARC. If the SAARC process were going on, I'm sure there would have been a solution which would have come up. But unfortunately, nothing like that is happening. And I think we are to blame, largely being the leader of the entire SAARC region, the big country which is there. And we have not been able to provide leadership. I remember being in Bhutan, Thimphu, where President Nasheed was there of Maldives. And he said that, you know, you cannot hold the entire process down, the entire grouping down, because India and Pakistan cannot resolve issues. You should just get the move on. But we don't. We have bureaucrats, we have diplomats who are most comfortable, mired in a kind of mindset on the issue of both sides, not just India alone, even Pakistan. We just can't get over our, the hatred that we have for each other.
Professor, if I can build on this, is it also because especially India has found a workaround as far as SAARC is concerned? We've got other regional groupings which are doing reasonably well, be it the BIMSTEC or many others that we've partnered with over the recent past to ensure that we bypass Pakistan, because Pakistan time and again has played spoilsport as well as far as SAARC is concerned. So has this become, a matter of convenience for India?
Thank you, Frank, for bringing up this positive perspective as well, because it's not as if SAARC is dead and gone and regionalism is no more. Partly, I think, first of all, one has to understand that because of too much glare and focus on India-Pakistan disjunctions, we sometimes overlook that there are other issues as well that contribute to the problems within SAARC. The entire South Asian region, for example, borders have been a problem for most of the countries. Terrorism has been a problem for most of the countries. Then, of course, one could go to the nitty-gritties of taxes and transnational crime and other issues, water sharing and so on. So it's a gamut of issues that creates that environment in which, of course, India being inordinately large and powerful country in the region, does have a certain responsibility, but we need to not just focus completely only to India-Pakistan, derailing the whole process. That is point number one. Second, as you mentioned, that even within SAARC, very clearly the summits have not taken place. And the last summit, as was mentioned by Ambassador Bhatia, was in Kathmandu, 2014. Even there, you would remember the Pakistan had not signed something called Regional Connectivity Agreement. So even that was undermined. But that had sort of laid out a roadmap of several achievements. And for the last 7 years, summit meeting has not taken place. But remember, this is not an annual summit. This is a biannual summit in that sense. And now let me come to the fact that there are very detailed, specialized bodies. Like, for example, you have South Asian University in Delhi, works fantastic. You have the SAARC Development Fund partly working fine. And of course, Arbitration Council in Islamabad. Likewise, there are regional centers, cultural center, for example, in Colombo, or agricultural center in Dhaka, or energy research center in Islamabad, TB, HIV, AIDS in Kathmandu. Now, these are structures which have been built over a period of time. They may not be working full steam, but they are not dead and gone. They are still active. Now, the third point, in terms of India exploring alternatives, the cooperation in the region has not completely disappeared. And there is a sort of alternative approach here, which we see, for example, whether it is South Asian Growth Quadrangle, which is BBIN, or it is Ganga Mekong Cooperation Initiative, or it is BIMSTEC. India has made sure that it can skirt through these difficulties and continue to engage its neighborhood. And neighborhood first is important for India if it has to rise as a major power and contribute to the larger region and global decision. So in that sense, I think we have to put things in perspective. Yes, SAARC is inactive briefly for about 7 years, definitely. It has been slow moving even before that for all these decades. It's not like it was super fast and suddenly came to a halt. And India has found other ways of dealing with the situation. And I think it's only inactive, but not dead and gone is what I'm saying.
Absolutely. All right. So this is an aspect that I want to take forward with you, Ambassador. So is SAARC still relevant today?
Indeed, that is the heart of the discussion today. My categorical answer is yes. SAARC represents the best hopes of regional cooperation and integration in South Asia. It was started with a good purpose. It was started with a lot of effort, overcoming skepticism, including of many important people in India. And it made progress. It was a situation of a half glass full, as Dr. Manmohan Singh, the previous prime minister, used to say. If we look at some of the facts, that will establish the relevance of SAARC in South Asia. South Asia hosts 21% of the world population. In a space which is barely less than 4% of the land of the world. So it's a heavily, densely populated area. And this population of 21% contributes to barely 4% of the world GDP. So it is also poor. Now, if you are poor, you are densely populated, and you have very small size of land of the world, what do you do? You need to sit together. We need to sit together, overcome our differences and conflicts, and begin to build bridges that create security and prosperity. This is what SAARC was all about. SAARC Charter talks of promoting the welfare of the people, economic growth, understanding on very many issues, and creating cooperation with regional and international organizations. So yes, SAARC is needed, but if you allow me just 1 minute, I want to respectfully disagree with my co-panelist, Shri Sanjay Kapoor. I think this is not just a matter of trust. I think why SAARC is in trouble can be explained by referring to three divergent perspectives. The Indian perspective is that Pakistan is entirely responsible because here is a state which uses terrorism against a member state as tool of its policy. No club can survive if one member is out to kill the other member. Second, the Pakistan perspective, which puts the blame squarely on India, and it goes back to history and Kashmir and the rest of it, and in a complete denial of responsibility for terrorism, which is not borne by any evidence, by any facts. So Pakistani case is really rather weak and feeble. And the third perspective has always been of the other countries, which find it much easier to simply say that it is India, Pakistan, who are responsible for this state of affairs, forgetting that they are establishing parity between a victim and the architect of terror. So I would say that our audience must first of all clearly understand and recognize as to why SAARC is in trouble. Only then, my dear friend, we can address the issue as to how we should establish its relevance and its future potential.
Absolutely. Talking about future potential, before the best way forward, Sanjay Kapoor, let me put this across. Do you see a revival as far as SAARC is concerned, the way things stand today?
I think the answer to your question has come from Ambassador Bhatia amply when he says that till that time that there is recognition of the fact that Pakistan is involved in acts of terror against a member country, and other countries which are also members recognize, do not recognize who the victim is. I think those kind of thoughts are going to ensure that we do not have an easy solution to solving the SAARC crisis. The fact of the matter is that in 1985, when it started, and right up to the point, the last summit meeting that took place in 2014, and the one which was cancelled subsequently, there was a certain movement that was happening in SAARC. So either you should deny whatever happened in the last, from 85 to 2013 and 14, and despite the fact that, we're pointing fingers at each other, there was a larger interest and larger purpose which was being fulfilled. I remember, that this terrorism as an issue has always been there. At one point in time, our former Prime Minister Manmohan Singh even called Pakistan a victim of terror, which was hotly debated, criticized, and he was ridiculed that how can a country like Pakistan be a victim of terror when it's been engaged in covert activities. But the fact of the matter is that when we call them non-state actors, when we call them an entity which are sometimes not controlled by whoever is in power, then you recognize that you could have situations like Islamic State, who could be independent of the government or the state power. So these are very tricky issues, but the fact is that if development is to reach the last person, if there has to be an improvement in the standards of living of people, if we do not want India to figure in the list of the countries with the highest inequality which has happened today, where we are shown to be absolutely heartless when it comes to providing succor to the needy, then we need to ensure, we have to see what benefits some masses and population more. And what has been recognized time and again is that if there was internal trade, if there was trade within the region itself, there would have been an increase in the creation of wealth for the entire South Asian region, or for that matter, subcontinent. But that hasn't really happened, primarily because we allow our, the atavism that drives our politics, our beliefs in a manner where we find it difficult to engage with anybody. Like Pakistan, obviously, is the reason why we don't. But look at our relationship with many other neighbors also. It is no longer what it used to be some years ago. Why is it happening like that? I mean, it is not just that SAARC has become irrelevant for us, but others have also recognized that there are limitations that are brought in by India, because India is, trying to sidestep, giving some kind of heft to BIMSTEC, to other groupings, just to keep the Pakistan out. But other countries have no problem working with Pakistan. It's only an India-centric problem. So we need to figure out. We have a problem with China, but we don't do what we do with Pakistan. We are still members of BRICS. We are still members of SCO. We don't have the guts to say, you came into our territory, you occupied 1,500 kilometers, and we're not going to attend. We will go and attend. We take part in every bilateral, multilateral meet. And I don't know what kind of explanation is to be given for attending those things despite the kind of muscular approach China has towards us.
Absolutely. Professor, taking the discussion forward now, let me bring in another aspect. So where does this leave all the other member states? And what about Afghanistan with everything that has happened there and all the political churning that we witnessed over the recent past in Afghanistan?
Let me say that it's a chicken and egg story in some ways. I heard Sanjay Kapoor say that if SAARC was active, maybe we could have found a solution to Afghanistan. But Afghanistan has been the problem. You remember last year in September, Nepal was trying to organize a foreign minister's meeting by the sidelines of General Assembly. And they could not come to consensus simply because they did not agree on who will sit on behalf of Taliban in that meeting. So that meeting couldn't take place. Indian Prime Minister last year in March also tried during the period of pandemic call an online conference. And we saw the kind of representation we received from Pakistan. So, you know, sometimes these problems could also be exasperating the positive sense of how we wish to connect and revive SAARC, which is for me is an excellent forum, very useful and has a lot of structures in place which could be revived to bring that strength. And let me make a very sharp point here. I think sometimes we are also very narrowly focused on regionalism being synonymous to the SAARC summit meetings not taking place. Regionalism has to be understood in terms of multiple imaginations. For example, there are cognitive regionalism, there is imagined communities, there's a soft regionalism. APEC is an example, very successful example of soft regionalism, where focus is on businesses, business houses, inter-societal linkages, and look at the advantage that South Asia has. What ultimately regionalism seeks to do? Regionalization, which means bring a shared identity. South Asia already has a very strong regional identity. We are all subcontinental, Indian subcontinental, South Asian people. We already have that strong identity among people, societies, and businesses. Now, states may have certain limitations in engaging with each other on certain issues particularly, but there are also enormous groundswell which we notice, which is available in case states want to take the initiative towards a positive outcome. China, of course, I want to just take another 10 to 15 seconds to say China definitely has emerged another stumbling block, shall we say, because the kind of overarching influence other than Thimphu and India, all other SAARC members are members of Belt and Road Initiative. All others want China to be made a full member. Definitely that influences, just like some of the small countries have small state syndrome vis-a-vis India. India is also very conscious of what China is willing to do and can do if it is given the full membership in SAARC organization. So what I'm underlining is not just limiting and caricaturing it to India, Pakistan, Tutu, Meme, leading to, you know, end of SAARC. It's a far more complex story, and there are multiple factors that go into it. Even instability in Maldives could be related here as to why SAARC is not kind of coming back into action. So it's a much complex and nuanced reality that we face at this stage. But in principle, SAARC is very useful frame to revive and sort of find out how we can promote welfare of people in the region, how we can contribute to economic resilience post-pandemic period. So in theory, great possibilities, but in practice, enormous amount of hiccups that each state, primarily India, has to overcome in reviving SAARC.
Wonderful. It's nice to have these subtle differences in opinion and each one of you putting across your points so convincingly. But there is one common thread, and we all understand that the matter is complex and needs to be dealt with in a very delicate manner if you really want to take it forward. Talking about taking things forward, final closing comments now from all my panelists with what needs to be done in the near future, in the immediate near future, to ensure that we see some kind of a revival as far as SAARC is concerned.
I think that is the central question, because the analysis must produce a kind of an advisory or a prescription for the future. So if we truly believe in the need for regional cooperation, if we truly believe in the continuing relevance of SAARC, and India is committed to the goal that were goals that were set out in the SAARC Charter, and India has shown that it is doing elsewhere in other platforms, and hope we will have a chance to discuss next time, perhaps BIMSTEC as well. I would say that there are several things that are open to India and to the other members of SAARC. I think this idea that only India has the responsibility is perhaps slightly misplaced. So I would first of all say that we must all recognize the central responsibility of China in obstructing the further success of SAARC. I think I agree with Professor Swaran Singh, and I think Sanjay ji also made a mention of the the Chinese factor. China has started a poverty alleviation initiative in South Asia. It is trying to gather together our neighbors and going ahead with some initiative without India. This is totally unacceptable. Whatever China's economic role may be in our region, it is not a South Asian country, and India would never accept China to play any preponderant role here. So we have to be clear about this, first of all, in India, and we should make this very clear in our neighborhood. My second suggestion is that India has to give a chance to diplomacy. We simply cannot have a situation where we do not have normal relations with our principal neighbor, Pakistan, despite all its, bad things that it has done to India. I think diplomacy should be given a chance. What Sanjay ji said has the potential for this. If we can deal with China, despite what China has done by way of border intrusion and invasion, if we do deal with them in all multilateral fora, SAARC is a multilateral fora at the regional level. We should deal with Pakistan at the multilateral fora in the region. We can quite conveniently have a summit for half a day, if necessary, in Islamabad, where our leaders go for 2 hours and get on with it. And then SAARC caravan can move forward and will start picking up the threats. And my third and last point essentially is that a very strong responsibility rests on our civil society, our think tanks, our platforms such as this, and indeed our youth. I think we need to be certainly nationalistic, but there is no need to be excessively nationalistic. I think a good mixture of nationalism and internationalism is what we need to see in the youth of India today. Then SAARC would have a future.
Absolutely. Sanjay Kapoor?
Yeah, I entirely agree with the prescription by Ambassador Bhatia. I think diplomacy has to be given a chance. I think the foreign minister's mandate has to include in a more vigorous and more defined way how to revive SAARC. He should be going around in the neighborhood talking about SAARC, that the imperative, having this kind of conversation, you can, do away with untouchability also. If all the 7 countries or 8 countries can come together in an online platform and talk to each other, you don't have to go to Islamabad to do it. The fact of the matter is, could be a beginning. You could have a virtual summit to start with, and you can go on. But I think at the end of the day, it's a resolve, it's the determination of the state to go on with it. If they don't have it, nothing will move forward. I think it's a great idea. They need to take it forward. We've already invested so many years from 1985 to 2014, 2019. And it'll be a pity if it just goes away because we just can't resolve matters between India and Pakistan. We should continue to engage. We should fight with them when it's required, but multilaterally, we should engage with our neighbors. That is what diplomacy is all about.
Absolutely. And Professor Swaran Singh, close the show for us with your concluding remarks.
Thank you, Frank. Apparently, all of us are in agreement that SAARC is relevant, that SAARC needs to be revived, and each one of us are suggesting the strategies. I come from an academic background. So in situations of what we call mutually hurting stalemate that goes on for a longer period of time, usual conflict resolution strategies prescribe focusing on peripheral actors and peripheral issues. So my recommendation would be, instead of hoping even for an hour-long summit meeting, which could be a bold initiative and could see leaders very reluctant because they always want to see what is in it for me, what is the return that I get by engaging leaders at that level, is to focus on incrementally issues that are really almost non-visible. Bureaucracies of SAARC and various centers, the regional initiatives, specialized agencies, and I agree with Ambassador Bhatia, involve civil society initiatives, involve in think tanks initiatives, for example, which are going to be less visible and perhaps more effective in taking the kind of building of that sentiment forward. And a very quick good example would be how, you know, these BRICS nations have been trying to come together over a period of time. Every summit is preceded by about 50 events to build those domestic constituencies, to make them feel that they are connected despite being sort of physically disconnected, different sizes, different levels, et cetera, et cetera. So if you are able to strengthen the constituencies on the ground, that perhaps would be far more effective way of reviving SAARC, rather than imagining that they could sort of begin from the top instead. So bottoms-up approach instead of top-down approach is what I would recommend. And I think that is going to be far more effective as far as my understanding is concerned.
Absolutely. All right, gentlemen, we'll have to leave it at that. Thank you so much for joining me on the program and putting things into perspective for us. Well, what's coming out of this discussion is that SAARC being derailed is a big disappointment, as there was scope for immense progress. Despite all the problems, it is still very relevant today. South Asia is still a very poor region, and if we want to see development reach everyone, we need regional cooperation and trade to flourish. For that, we have to sit down and sort out our differences. We have to give diplomacy a chance. Members will also have to step up, since making SAARC work is not solely India's responsibility. Others too need to come to the table and take it forward. India's concerns with regards to Pakistan and more importantly China are highly justified. China wanting membership into the grouping is a big problem, and we should all understand that China is not a part of South Asia. Before I go, let me once again remind you to like the video, subscribe, and share the video as well, so that more people get to know about Bharata First. Do subscribe to our newsletter to get some incisive information. And how can I not tell you about the Bharata First Knowledge Center, our big success story? It is your one-stop destination for all your competitive exams needs. We now have 26 amazing courses, all available at less than 1,000 rupees per course as part of our early bird offer. We are also offering an additional discount of 10% for the first 100 to register. So what are you waiting for? Make use of this great opportunity and register now at kc.bharatafirst.com, because seats are limited and this offer is going to be there only for a few more days. So register right now. Hundreds are reaping the benefits of the Knowledge Center. Don't be left behind and don't regret later. All this information along with some must-see recommendations are in the description of the video. Please go through it. That's it from me. See you again next time.